The whole west wing is out. What's going on? This happened a month ago and the maintenance guy said he fixed the problem. They said it was a bad x-ray machine that tripped a breaker, but apparently it's not fixed. This is ridiculous. Somebody's going to hear about this.
Everyone has experienced a power outage. Understanding why the power went out is very important. In some instances, there are significant financial losses associated with power interruptions, and in some cases, like this hospital example, it could be worse. Here at the Power Systems Experience Center, we help customers solve all types of power system problems, from power quality problems to design issues. Sometimes, our visitors ask us to help them with power system studies like short circuit, coordination, and arc flash studies. Oftentimes, we call on our friends in the front of our building in the Power System Engineering, or PSE, group. These engineers are some of the top engineers in the country with many years of experience in analyzing power systems. In this video, we will highlight a few of the key studies that the PSE group performs. Specifically, we will focus on short circuit and coordination studies, as well as highlight the importance of arc flash analysis. We feel very fortunate to have access to these experts here at the PSEC. They love to be challenged. Bring your problems to us, and collectively, with your input, we'll help you solve them.
Short circuit analysis is done for three primary purposes. First, to compare the available fault current to the interrupting duty of the protective devices. Secondly, to provide information for time current coordination of the protective devices. And finally, to calculate the incident energy during arc flash analysis. The first step in performing a short circuit study is to build the impedance network for the electrical power system. This includes all impedance elements and electrical sources. Impedance elements include things like transformers, cables, and busway. Electrical sources include the utility source, on-site generation, and induction motors with rotating inertia. Engineers can estimate the fault current using rule-of-thumb calculation methods by simplifying the network to a few buses and impedance elements. However, today, most engineers use computer simulation programs like SKM, ETAP, or SIME. The computer software allows a visual input of data on a one-line diagram for a few buses or a few thousand buses. The output of a short circuit study compares the interrupting rating of breakers and fuses to the available fault current. If a device is overdutied, meaning that the available fault current is greater than the device rating, the study will usually recommend replacement of the device for existing systems or selecting of a different device for new designs. For example, if the fault current was calculated as 45,000 amps and the protective device was rated at 35 kA, a 65 kA device might be recommended so that it can withstand the 45,000 amp fault. Electrical faults must be cleared by devices that have the electrical and mechanical capability to clear the fault and within a reasonable amount of time so that the other electrical devices on the power system are not damaged. A short circuit study is the first step in ensuring protection of your system.
A coordination study uses time current curves to compare the settings of the protective devices on your power system, usually starting from the utility incoming service down to the breaker or fuse just upstream of your loads. A coordination curve, or time current curve, plots the tripping characteristics of the breaker or fuse so that you could compare and adjust the settings to coordinate them for your system. Now, ideally, during a fault condition, the closest upstream device near the fault should disconnect that part of the electrical system to prevent the rest of the system from disruption. Although at first glance, it would appear that all you need to do for a coordination study is provide the settings for all of your protective devices so that there is no overlap in the trip curves. But this is often nearly impossible to do. There are so many combinations that may work, some better than others, and many considerations, such as protecting equipment, for codes and standards, maintaining proper time intervals between relays, and most importantly, determining how to balance the trade-offs between coordination and protection. It is for this reason that protective device coordination is often referred to as an art rather than a science. The first step in setting protective devices for a coordination study is to determine the available fault current. This helps you determine the maximum range of current where the devices must coordinate. On the low current end, the devices should coordinate all the way down to the overload condition, which usually relates to the handle rating of the breakers or the nominal rating of the fuses. Otherwise, a simple overload could de-energize more of the system than you would prefer. Selective coordination adds a whole new dimension, and by some definitions, it means perfect coordination for all currents at all times. But for other situations, it could mean all currents down to a certain time, like 0.1 seconds or 0.01 seconds. Our PSEC group can help you determine what is appropriate for your situation based on the codes and standards for your business and region. Other important considerations must be taken into account when an engineer analyzes your power system, including motor starting curves and transformer inrush. In either of these cases, the protected device setting must be set above or beyond the temporary inrush condition so that the breaker or fuse will not nuisance trip during startup. Sometimes, because of unique field conditions or motor designs, the breaker settings developed during the study are tweaked in the field to overcome inrush trips. It's a delicate balance between protection of the equipment and coordination of devices. Our studies team is here to help simplify the selection of protective devices and help you set them to optimize the protection and selectivity, as well as arc flash safety for your system.
Arc flash safety is one of the most important issues facing our industry today. With proper training and analysis, you can comply with the latest safety standards and keep yourself and your employees safe. The first step is completing an arc flash study. Our PSEC group has done thousands of arc flash studies and applied solutions for our customers' facilities and our own Eaton sites. The results of a short circuit and coordination study are used to complete the arc flash analysis. Similar to a coordination study, there are often variations in the results based on the settings of the devices and the engineering judgment exercised by the study's engineer. Individual results also depend on the varying operating conditions of the specific power system. Generally, the output of an arc flash study is a label for each critical location showing the available arc flash energy in calories per centimeter squared and the distance a worker should stand to avoid a second degree or non-curable burn if an arc flash were to occur. The incident energy defines the appropriate personal protective equipment or PPE required when performing live work. The NFPA 70E standard provides a guideline for analyzing power systems, determining PPE and safe work practices. OSHA has used the NFPA 70E standard in the past following a reported arc flash incident, but more recently they have been more proactive in their approach to arc flash safety. Following the completion of an arc flash study for your system, we provide the arc flash labels and the training. This ensures that your people understand the latest regulations and the information on the labels. We perform calculations for multiple scenarios when completing an arc flash study. For example, we determine the incident energy at a maximum fault current level and at a minimal fault current level. The maximum current level may increase the energy because of the high fault current, but the protective device may likely trip faster, which could reduce the incident energy. Conversely, the low fault current level could increase the incident energy if the fault is allowed to persist, since the protective device may take longer to trip. Determining which of these scenarios is worse is important for understanding how to label the system and for applying solutions to minimize arc flash levels. As you can see, there are many things to consider when performing an arc flash analysis. Our PSEC group is here to help you analyze your system and come up with the right solution for you. Short circuit, coordination, and arc flash studies are required analysis for commercial and industrial power systems. Eaton's Power Systems Engineering Group has more than 130 power systems engineers regionally located that can help you analyze your power system. In addition, our PSEC group can help you with other power system studies like load flow, power factor, and harmonic analysis.
Here at the Power Systems Experience Center, we can connect you with the PSEC group and help you determine the best course of action for analyzing your power system. Contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to the PSEC today and to learn more about our Power Systems Engineering Group.